Travis. I trained in medicine back in the 60s in Boston, then I did a residency in preventive medicine at Johns Hopkins in the 70s. I found that it wasn't really prevention, but early detection. And I stumbled across a book called High Level Wellness that led to my opening the first wellness center in the US in 1975. And for 5 years, I worked with adults doing wellness. Then I saw that the system was so broken that we needed to look at doctors and nurses and how they needed to understand wellness. Did that for 8 or 10 years. Then I discovered that the real issue is how we treat infants. The normative abuse, I call it, of what passes for a normal way of raising a child, which includes things like circumcision, were far more destructive, and we could do a lot more good by addressing those issues than the downstream work I'd been doing with adults and issues later on. So my work has been dedicated to infant wellness for the last 20 years. Infant wellness, it's not a term that I've even heard. I've started using it, but I haven't heard anyone else use it. And I think it's crucial. What happens in utero in the first 9 months out of the uterus are formative for our whole life. And it has much more impact than anything else in our life. So the issues that occur, like going back to my own birth in rural Ohio in the 40s, it was a full ether anesthesia. My mother was knocked out. I was dragged out with forceps. I was circumcised. I was bottle fed on a 4-hour schedule. She tried to breastfeed me, but didn't know how, and they didn't bother to show her how. And it was pretty abusive. And a lot of wounding, a lot of the issues I've dealt with in my life come out of that period, but also the gifts. I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. I wouldn't be interested in wellness were it not for struggles with my own wellness. So what my life is about is trying to prevent this for other kids. And the single most needless traumatic experience for boys is having 3/4 of the nerve endings of their penis cut off when they're a day or two old. It's completely unnecessary, extremely painful, and has consequences for the rest of their life. As they say, you don't remember it, but you'll never forget it. So what's cut off? Well, I never saw mine or didn't get to experience it, so it's what I've read about and studied, but it, as a personal experience, I and most North American males haven't a clue, including the doctors. And I think that's why they're so nonchalant about whacking it off, because they don't know what they're missing, or they think they're not missing anything. But we know from research that it's exquisitely sensitive as your tongue or lips, but the nerves have a different role. They are involved in orgasm. And there are many circumcised men who think they're too sensitive. Well, and in a sense they are. In fact, Dr. Oz yesterday on Oprah said that circumcised men are more sensitive. He's got it backwards. What's happened is that we basically wind up with an on-off switch instead of having an accelerator. And there's an old joke, why do women fake orgasm? Well, because men fake foreplay. Well, why do men fake foreplay? Well, they don't have the equipment to enjoy it with. So you can really trace it back to this barbaric practice of removing 3/4 of our nerve endings, leaving us as sexual cripples, and we try to make it through life without realizing what we're missing. I'm sure Viagra sales are much, much higher as a result. All of the issues with erectile dysfunction and premature ejaculation, they've never been adequately studied with circumcision because there's no money in it. You know, big drug companies can do these multi-billion dollar studies because they're going to make money with a drug. It's not been studied properly. So we do know from one study that was published that we're missing about 3/4 of the nerve endings. The most sensitive parts of the penis are on the foreskin. Masters and Johnson started this myth 40-some years ago with human sexual response, where they said, and actually it was just Masters, Johnson didn't know anything about it. We had someone who went to interview her. What they said was actually true. There is no difference in the glands between a circumcised and an intact male, but they measured the wrong part. The glands is the least sensitive part of the penis. So, big deal. The part of the penis that's cut off is the most sensitive, particularly the frenulum, the part where it attaches at the bottom. And so the fact that this wasn't studied until 3 years ago And we've been doing it over 100 years. If we were to institute circumcision now, it would be required to go through all kinds of testing and approval and so forth. It would never pass. But the fact that it's been grandfathered in through culture and custom allows it to continue. And the painful part that men don't want to look at, they don't want to consider that they might be damaged, particularly doctors. So it remains the giant elephant in the living room that no one talks about, or when you do talk about it, people get upset. One of the things that we miss in all of this concern about circumcision is the object itself, the foreskin. What's its function? From the useless flap of skin to God's gift to man, which is really refers to the frenulum, the most sensitive part underneath, which in the circumcised man is a scar, and it's still the most sensitive. So what the foreskin can actually do, I put a little questionnaire together, about 12 questions, and I started giving it to doctors. Average score was 5 out of 12 of the doctors that I know. And simple things like, how big is it? What age is a boy fully retractable? And the myth that it should be retractable by 2 or 3 isn't at all true. It's the median age when half the boys are fully retractable is over age 10. So for many boys, it's well into their teens before it's retractable. These things aren't known to doctors because they've never had a foreskin. They don't know anything about it. And they are erroneously encouraging mothers to retract, doing it themselves, causing this damage, which then leads to the need to circumcise because the boy's got scarring from iatrogenic illness. And this is going on right under our noses. There's enormous number of cases. I wrote an article about this a year or so ago and then talked about it at a public program. 3 people came up to me and described this phenomenon, and it wasn't that big of an audience. So it's a much bigger problem than I had any idea of, and it's not getting any press at all. So the question of young mothers and fathers deciding whether to circumcise or not, and they often said, well, what are the pros and cons? Well, there really are no pros. When you look at it, there is no solid research that's a pro. There are lots of cons, and they aren't getting much press. But the real important thing, I think, for any parent to consider or to do before they consider it is to watch a video of a boy being circumcised. If you do that, no question, you won't do it. It's one of the most painful things you can watch. And because it's so gruesome and because it's done behind closed doors, and the parents who do experience it or hear their own son crying after it's too late, regret it. But if this were made public, if people could see the angry look on the boy's face after he's basically been raped, been castrated in a sense, against his will, strapped down, the night terrors that many adult men wake up with, the therapies that is done, it's most cases the men don't even recognize where the trauma has come from, but it's an enormous problem right under our noses that most therapists don't appreciate. It's a kind of PTSD. We've got a lot of attention on PTSD from adult trauma, but when you're an infant and you don't have words, you don't have the verbal reality, it's harder to name it, and yet it's there. You think that you don't remember it, but you never forget. And that becomes a theme in a man's life. It's an enormous problem that needs to be addressed.